Many of you may know my name if you are attending my webinar, you know, second time or third time. I'm CEO of RefineM. We started this company in 2011. We do agile transformation, project management, consulting, training, and we have also developed projects for project professionals, like Essential Gear for Project Manager is a toolkit that any project manager can use if they are using Waterfall to deliver their projects. We have a PMP exam simulator. We have PMP videos that you can use. Also, we have a couple of other videos that we have created or courseware that we have created. And also, we have created a agility assessment tool. And we are going to talk about that in the next webinar, but it's a tool that any team can use to assess their agility. So that's what is happening since 2011. And before that, I spent more than 20 years of my career in project leadership, leading, delivering all kind of projects, recovering projects from from the place where they went into trouble, and implemented numerous process improvements, coached many professionals, and so on. So my whole career is on project management, and that's what I do, that's what I like, and that's what I feel it's fun for me. Okay, so what's new at RefineM? So next two webinars, as I was talking about agility assessment, what is the meaning of that? How do you assess agility of your team or your organization? So we'll talk more on September 4th. That's when we are going to do that. And then we are going to do the similar webinar or the similar or maybe the same webinar at projectmanagement.com on October 3. And I do that once a quarter to get a larger audience. And that is actually very helpful to spread the message around. Most of my webinars that I have delivered on projectmanagement.com were very well attended. I get probably about 2,000 people, 1,000, 2,000 people in those webinars from all over the world. So that's a good forum for me to share my ideas with a wider audience. So that's what is going to happen on October 3rd. We have several new trainings and outreach program and the products that we just talked about. So a lot of activity going on and happening at RefineM, other than, of course, we are doing client projects and consulting and training engagements with the customers. So sprint planning. We are going to start with some introductions to bring everybody on the same page. I know many of you said you have been using Scrum. Some of you said that they are new. So let's bring everybody on the same page together. So we'll start with that, and then we'll talk about challenges in sprint planning. What are the goals of sprint planning activities? And a very important aspect which many teams miss is about capacity planning. And I will spend some time over that, because I found at least in two or three engagements that I did in the past that was a big issue. And I will talk about the issues also. And then what are the outputs we get after we finish the sprint planning? So this is the picture of Scrum, how Scrum works. So Scrum starts with product planning. I think one of the things that I have seen is many teams don't do these two parts well, and they just jump into doing sprints. And of course, then they run into blockers and roadblocks and all those kind of things. And then they go back and do some of this, but not done in a proactive manner. So Scrum starts with product planning, where you create a vision, a product roadmap, and product backlog. And that is the initial product backlog, where you dump almost everything. And most probably at this stage, the backlog is going to be mostly themes and epics, maybe features, functions, may not be user stories at this level. But whatever ideas, whatever thoughts come out, this should be included in the product. This should be included in the product. This should be included in the product. So that goes in the product backlog, and then it gets prioritized. And after that, if you figure out that your project is going to be longer than I'll say 3 months or so, then you may need to do release planning. Release planning are the when you are going to release the set of functionality. You may not be able to release at the end of each sprint. You may develop a fully production deployable code, but you may not be able to release because of other restrictions, dependencies, and maybe there are organizational constraints or it may not make much sense, whatever that is. So you may not be able to release, even though you may be producing production ready code at the end of each sprint. So you may need some releases. Maybe if you are running 2 week sprints, you may need release every month, maybe every 2 months or whatever. So this is an optional part. So if you are not releasing to production at the end of every sprint, then you may need release planning. And the release planning will basically say how long is the release, how many sprints, and what goes in each sprint, and what is the goal of the release planning, and what is expected to be delivered at the end of release. So that's release planning, and then the sprint. And most of you who are attending today's webinar will know about that there are 4 ceremonies, and we'll get deeper into this. And at the end of the sprint, you have a fully deployable code, and you just have this keep going in this sprint to sprint. And if you have releases, then you pass on the code to the wait for the release to happen, and then the release happens, and then you go back, and then you go back to the next release, and so on. So So the cycle continues until your product development is complete or the project that you started is complete. So that's a high level, and I don't expect anybody will have any questions. So I'm moving forward. Scrum is an iterative and incremental software development framework. We all know that. These are the 3 pillars of Scrum: transparency, inspection, and adaptation. So transparency means everybody knows everything, whatever is going on. So that's a very key aspect of Scrum, that everybody is very, very very aware what's going on. And then at intervals, you do inspection, like you do reviews at the end of the sprint, you do retrospectives at the end of the sprint, and even on a daily basis, you do some kind of inspection and adaptation. Some of the key artifacts that come out of Scrum are product increment, which is like at the end of the sprint, you have developed a production deployable code. So that part or that portion is called as product increment. And at the end of each sprint, you have product increment that's get added to the product that is already developed. And also the product backlog, so it is updated. So basically whatever you got completed, you get the backlog will get reprioritized and based on whatever is remaining to be done. So that's another artifact of the Scrum. And then sprint backlog is another one that is used at the beginning of the sprint. A sprint backlog is created, which is highly visible to the team, and team uses the sprint backlog to do their work. And then at the end of the sprint, you go and review what were the things that were completed from the sprint backlog. So that's another artifact that we use in Scrum. Roles, there are 3 primary roles in the Scrum: the product owner, who represents the stakeholders, and also he or she is the voice of the customer. So this is a very key role, very, very key role, because this is the person who has very good knowledge of the product that is being developed. He is instrumental in creating the roadmap. And also he works with the business side, the stakeholders, and all the users who are going to use the product, and brings their input and their feedback to the table, and then organizes all of that and creates a backlog. And then prioritizes the backlog and makes sure that the team works on high priority items in every sprint. So team takes the high priority item, they work on that sprint. And then when the next sprint comes, he makes sure that he has groomed the backlog. And I'm using the word groomed here. Groomed means he has detailed out the backlog, he has prioritized the backlog, and it's ready to go. So that is something that he does, and he makes sure the team always work on high priority items. A very important role. So you can think product owner as the driver, somebody who is driving the project. It's not the Scrum Master who is driving. It's the product owner who is driving. If a Scrum Master drives, that it means the product owner is not an effective product owner, or there may not be a product owner in the team. I have seen many teams work without a product owner and they struggle. So in those cases, sometimes the Scrum Masters takes the initiative and they start driving. But guess what? The Scrum Masters don't know product functionality, right? So they may not be able to make the right kind of decisions, and that may create different kind of problems. So what is Scrum Master does? A Scrum Master is basically, he is a servant leader. So he helps the team to follow the Scrum process. He is a SME for Scrum. He knows how Scrum works. And he helps team understand Scrum and helps team understand implement. He may facilitate different ceremonies that we are going to talk about. Basically, he's a facilitator. And also, the second part of Scrum Master is that he will make sure that impediments are identified and removed so the team keeps moving forward. So he may not be skilled to remove those impediments by himself or herself, but he or she will make sure that those impediments are removed. He will know where to go and how to work on those impediments and how to remove those impediments. And then, of course, the team which work on the tasks, and they may be specialist, or ideally they should be generalizing specialist, means they can do more than one kind of work. They are skilled in doing more than one kind of work. So those are the key roles. Now there could be other roles like, you know, project manager, business analyst, and all that. And those may exist, and each team may define those roles based on their context and their situation. But in Scrum, these are the three roles that are defined. Okay. So talking about ceremonies. So there are four key ceremonies. Sprint planning is one of them, a very key ceremony. And usually for a two-week sprint, it may take up to 4 hours. Sometimes once the teams become mature and they know how to do sprint planning and there is enough pre-work done before the planning, it may take even less than 2 hours. But in the beginning, when the teams are starting, it may take up to 4 hours. So you can think of anything between 2 to 4 hours. This is like a guiding, use it as a guide, not as a kind of rule. But it's sprint planning is not like a 30-minute thing also. It may take some time, but it's not a whole day kind of thing too. But yeah, if you have a longer sprint duration, it may take a day, okay? Usually, teams you run two-week sprints, so for them, 2 to 4 hours for the sprint planning is good. So, and also, this is divided into two parts. Part one focuses on what the team is being asked to build. So kind of a scope of the sprint. What is going to be built in this sprint? And product owner leads this conversation, works with the team, so his presence or attendance in this portion of sprint planning is important. Now, the second part, once it is decided, what is included in the scope of the sprint. Then the team gets into action and they say, okay, now how we are going to do this? Who is going to do what? Maybe sometimes, maybe just the technical discussions on how we are going to accomplish this and things like that. So that's the team that team together works and figures out how they are going to deliver this functionality at the end of this sprint. Product owner may or may not attend the second portion of the sprint planning. And then, before we go further, let's take a little survey. So I'm going to start a survey, and what I'll need is, let's see if I can bring the survey guy. Okay, yeah, here it is. So let me start this survey. And I have launched the poll. So you should see this. So what do you think, in your opinion, what's the challenge that you face? So which of the following challenges do you face in your sprint planning? I'll give you really about maybe no more than a minute. So I see a couple of people getting onto it and doing this survey. Very good. Very good. Yeah, keep going. I got about 1/3 of people responded to the survey. Okay, very good. Now we are at 56%. Keep going. Some of you who have not done it, please express your opinion. So we are about 70% done. So a little more time. Let's see. Very good. We have 5 or 6 people left who have not voted for the survey. I'll give you maybe another 10, 15 seconds. I have about 78% people voted. Okay, somebody said I don't use Sprint, which is fine, absolutely fine. So I'm going to end the poll and let's see if I can display the result. End the poll and let me share the results. Does everybody see the results? Philip, if you can type here, does everybody see the results? I just want to make sure that everybody is seeing the results. Yes, we see them. Okay, very good. Very good. So it's not surprising. The backlog is not groomed for the detail level. I think that's the topmost issue, which again is 78% of you voted for that issue. So that's the biggest issue. So I'm with you. I have seen that happen time and over and over again, that grooming is a big challenge. It's a huge challenge. And that challenge comes because many teams, many product owners, business analysts who are responsible for grooming the backlog, they actually don't know how to groom. They don't know how to detail things out. They don't know what are the steps that they are going to follow to groom the backlog. So this is a skill. That's a new skill that need to be developed. And this is a part of requirement gathering. That part is actually totally dropped when teams move from waterfall to agile. So before, when teams were using waterfall, there was a very formal requirement gathering process. The business analyst will sit down with the SMEs and users and stakeholders, gather requirements, document requirements in whatever form they want to create a business requirement document, and it will be reviewed and signed. And until that happens, not a single piece of code was written. So that was good thing, but there was another problem because it may take 2-3 months to do the requirements and then nothing happens. People, you have other kind of issues. And where agile helps. But in this case, when people move to agile, they just start looking for stories, and stories is a small unit. And every time you try to create a story and then you start discussing detail, it starts becoming bigger, right? And suddenly you're like, oh, this is not one story, right? This is much bigger. So that's usual. So I have seen, and other one, like here you have team is not skilled in estimating. That's another challenge. I agree with that. product backlog is not prioritized, which is part of the grooming too, because grooming includes prioritization. And then sprint backlog is too big or too small. Very good. Very good. Excellent. So let's move on. So grooming seems to be the biggest challenge. Okay. All right. So let's talk about what are the goals of a sprint planning. So there are two fundamental goals. So to answer these questions, so they are in the terms of questions. What can be delivered in this sprint? Basically, it says, what is the scope of this sprint? What we are going to deliver at the end of this sprint? So that's the goal. And the second question, that, you know, how will the work be delivered? So what is delivered and how it should be delivered? So those are the goals of sprint planning. If we have answered these two questions at the end of the sprint planning, we have achieved the objective of the sprint. So two questions need to be answered. What can be delivered, the scope, and how will the work be delivered? What and how? These two questions are answered. And so the planning is complete if you know the answers of these questions. Do you think of any other question that need to be answered during the planning or at the end of the planning? Any other question that you think should be answered? You can use the chat box to type your message. Any other question that you think sprint planning should answer other than these two, in your experience, in your view? Confirm the sprint goal. Okay, very good. Yeah, okay. Very good. So I'm seeing some of the questions here. Can we do it? Can we actually do it? So that is the first part. And the second part together is, can we actually do it? You know, any skill shortage? Yeah, that is all part of can we do it or how we'll do it. The when you start talking about how the skills come into question, do we have enough skills to do this? What kind of skills will be needed to complete each of the stories? You know, who will be involved? Yeah, excellent. So I think those are the sub questions below these questions. The questions. So very good. Yeah. All those questions are reasonable. And then we talk about what are the activities of the sprint planning. What happens during the sprint planning? So it understand what needs to be done. Like product owner is telling, okay, these are the things that we want to do. These are the stories that we want to be delivered in this thing. And what is that story? So what understanding of the what need to happen or the scope of the sprint or the stories in the sprint. So what need to happen, and then finalize the sprint goal. So what is the goal of the sprint? So earlier slide was talking goal of the sprint planning. Now this is different. This is each sprint may have a goal that in this sprint we want to achieve this and this. Maybe just a one line about that, and it you may not say, oh, we have to complete these five stories. You know, so that's not the goal. So the goal could be little higher level, that we want to complete this feature in this sprint. So we might have done some stories related to that feature in previous sprints, and we are saying, okay, let us do these two stories. So the objective of the sprint is to complete this feature. Of course, you're going to work on other stories too, but that becomes the goal. Or there could be many problems reported. So sprint goal could be, we are going to improve the quality of the product in this sprint. So it could be anything. Now, and then based on that goal, you include the stories in the sprint. Of course, you need to evaluate your sprint capacity. Somebody was talking about, can we actually do it? So what is the capacity of the team? Do we have enough people in the team to take on this work and complete it? So what's the capacity? And I'm going to talk about capacity planning in a lot more details in the coming slide, because that is one thing that many teams do not do in the right way, particularly the teams that have just started with Agile. So I'm going to talk about that. Forecast what we deliver at the end of the sprint. So we'll be complete these stories, these things, and all those kind of things. Estimate the work. That is another activity that happens during the sprint planning, estimating the work. So you know, okay, this is the volume of work we have. And on the other side, we have this capacity. So matching the two. Now, somebody said, can we actually deliver? So that is what is required, that you have, you estimate the work related to the scores that were included in the sprint. And that estimation happens during the planning. Create review definition of done. That's another very, very important thing, that maybe in first sprint or so, you decide, you create the definition of done. And then at the end of each sprint, at the beginning of each sprint, when you're doing sprint planning, you review it. Is that definition of done still valid? Is everybody happy with that definition of done, or we need to change it? Because based on the definition of done, the product owner is going to mark stories done or not done. So important is to have a clearly defined and accepted definition of done, and that part should be taken care of during the sprint. It may just be a minute thing. We look at the definition of done. If it is third, fourth, fifth sprint, yeah, this looks fine. Let's move on. It could be just that, or it could be, oh, I think we should include this. Oh, I think we should not include this aspect, and all those kind of things. So definition of done, and then the objectives of the sprint. What the product owner talking about, and then clarify and prioritize the work and make trade-offs. So that product owner does clarification, prioritization, and sometimes the team comes back with the estimate and they say, may not be able to do this. So there could be some trade-offs for a particular story, or maybe more than one story. So there could be some trade-offs that can be negotiated at during the sprint planning. And then facilitation of sprint planning that is done by Scrum Master. So there are several activities that take place during the sprint, and that is why it is not a 20-30 minute thing. It takes little time, and the Scrum Masters who are experienced in Scrum, they know what is needed in the sprint planning. You can shorten the length of sprint planning by doing proactive planning or doing certain activities before the sprint planning, like estimating stories. So if the estimated stories are already estimated, then you don't spend time in estimating. Okay, so that's one of the examples. Now your sprint capacity, if a Scrum Master has already worked with the team and then figured out the capacity before the sprint planning, then you don't have to, you just have to take that as given. And then basically match it with the scope and see if it matches or not. So there are things that can be done before the sprint planning, and then you can shorten the sprint planning duration. And that will be very good to do, because sprint planning is attended by the whole team. So if some of the things a couple of people do outside that meeting or sprint planning meeting, it will be saving time for everybody. So that's a good thing. That's a very, very good thing. Now, I was talking about sprint capacity planning. So this is one of the things, one of the core reasons why teams don't finish the scope that was initially agreed upon. Why there are half done stories left at the end of the sprint. So you may pick up 6 stories and then you figure out, oh, we have completed 2, another 3 are like 80% done, and so on and so forth. And that creates a lot of problems. First of all, the velocity goes out of the door. You really don't know what your velocity is. Because if the story is not complete, you're not supposed to include in the velocity. Okay. But sometimes team may say, oh, we will apply that percentage complete thing and we'll use that. But that's not the right thing to do. And that doesn't give a very, accurate picture of the velocity. So velocity is best done if the team doesn't change, the team is stable, and we have small stories that can be completed. And that's very important. So the two parts, the stories may not be small. That's one reason. The other reason for this is that you may add up all the work. Let's say you had five stories and that adds up to 20 story points, okay? And somehow those 20 story points, if your team is translating into the hours and all that, so let's say that 20 story point translate to, maybe I'm just picking up a number. So 20 story points translate to, let's say, 40 hours. I'm just picking up a number. Now, you look at your team and you say, oh, okay, we have this person, this person, this person, this person, add up their hours, they add up to 40 hours. So we should be good, right? But actually, that may not be true, because the skill set needed for each story, that may not be in the same proportion as you have capacity available. So let's say these six story need lot of UI work, just the nature of story, right? You need lot of UI work, but then you have only 50% person available to do the UI work. So other people cannot do UI work. So the skill needed to complete these six stories, there's a lot of UI component, whereas in you do not have the similar capacity for UI work, so you lack that capacity. So that creates a problem. So that is why the Scrum Masters should focus on making sure that the volume of work that need to be completed across different skills, not the total, across different skills matches with the capacity on similar skills. That's absolutely very, very important. If you are not doing that, then you will run into problems of your stories remain partially complete. So think about this example of UI. If there was a more UI capacity needed and it was not present, then the other pieces of that story will get completed, but not UI, right? So that will result in a partially completed story. And then you will have an issue of how do I measure the velocity? Is the team really getting better or not? The velocity is a measure to figure that out, right? If the velocity keeps improving or getting better, then the teams are getting more productive. But if the velocity measure itself is faulty, then how do you know it? So that's a bigger issue. And for this purpose, in my consulting work, I have created a sprint capacity planning sheet. You can download this from my website. This is available for free. So you can download from the website, just go and type the capacity planning spreadsheet and you'll get in under the knowledge base area. So you can see here, so I have kept it based on the different kinds of work. So first of all, you need to know that there could be if the person is 100% available, they don't spend 100% of their time in the doing the work they have. They may have vacations, they may have, non-project or non-sprint work, which may be sitting over here, some like admin, training, meetings, production fixes, backlog grooming, because you are going to pull some people in backlog grooming part of it. So backlog grooming, and so that all need to be taken away. So this is the capacity left for the development work, the stories. And now this is what capacity you have, like UI. So you have this much capacity, 2.5, whatever that unit is. So this, you have 2.5 of this. You have developer one, developer two. That is the development capacity. And if these developers are different type of developers, maybe there's a .NET developer, there is a Java developer. So you can say dev one Java, dev two C or whatever, or database developer. And then this is the quality assurance, you know, different kind of testing. Maybe there is one person who does the testing, other person does the automation work. So need to put these all together and say, okay, this is my total capacity for each of these areas. And then go and match this with the work that is coming up. That will help you tell that, okay, can we achieve this or not? Okay. So this is very, very important, doing capacity planning to see what the team is capable of delivering. So one side on the sprint planning, you have that this is what product owner would like the team to do. And on the other side with the sprint capacity planning, you know, okay, how do I deliver this? You know, do I have capacity across different skills to deliver that? Okay. Let's move on. So sprint planning outputs. So there are three major outputs. Sprint goal. What is the overall goal for the sprint? Sprint backlog. Like what is going to be delivered, like scope for the sprint, and definition of done. Updated, I have written in the bracket, updated. If that is updated, if not updated, then the definition of one from the previous sprint carries forward. So those are the three key outputs from sprint planning. So in conclusion, yeah, sprint planning is made more effective with the right people in the room. So that's very, very important. The people, the product owner, the scrum masters, the team members, they all need to be there. So don't miss any key person from the, actually it will be great if you have everybody participate in the sprint planning. So you need to have the right people and all the people in the room to do the sprint planning. Having a properly groomed backlog. So many of you in the survey said that's a challenge or that's the issue. So I'm saying that if you have groomed your backlog properly, if your product owner has taken care of it, if he or she has groomed the backlog with enough details, so the team, when team picks up the story, they have all the details that they want to know about the story. So that if it is properly groomed, then your planning will be more accurate. So your sprint backlog and the scope, what you determine will be more accurate, because then you know that you're not going to discover new functionality, new things. And so if it is fully detailed, you know about it, okay? Paying attention to available capacity. That is what we just talked about. Paying attention to and agreeing on definition of done. So these are the four aspects. So first is we need to have all the people, everybody participating in sprint planning. Second, we need to have properly groomed backlog before the sprint planning. Third, we need to have available capacity, right? Available capacity to help with the planning. And then during the planning, we agree on definition of done. So that those are the four very important aspects of sprint planning. Okay, so let's see. So that is all for now. So you can put your questions in the chat box. I have a couple of slides and I will come back to your questions in about a couple of minutes. So have your questions in the chat box. Our next lunch and learn is about agility assessment. Okay, so if you want to know where your team is on agility or agile maturity, how do you know that? And so what we have done, we have created a assessment tool. And first we are going to talk about assessment, and then we are going to talk about the tool, how the tool does assessment, and then you can continue assessing it over and over and over again over a period of time, and you can see how your team is improving in agility. So we'll do that on September 4 at noon, and you can register. The registration is open right now. You can register for that webinar. Then we are going to do a one-day full class on the web, which is on August 24. There's about Agile for Waterfall and Operational Work. So Agile has been used for software development work or product development work for many years or from the very beginning. But this can be used, Agile can be used in any kind of situation, any kind of work, even waterfall. Even for waterfall projects, you can use some of the Agile practices. And for operational work means that is not even IT related. For example, recruiting, purchasing, and many other operational work, there you may not even think about how can I use Agile in purchasing. No. So we're going to talk about all that. So Agile is actually for all. Anybody can use Agile, whether they are doing software development work or they are not doing software development work. So this is if you want to register, the registration is still open, and it's on August 24 over the web. Just like this. And some of the products, agility assessment, we'll talk about that in the next webinar. And we have a series on Agile fundamentals. It's a one-day class divided into probably multiple videos and total of 9 hours. So if you are new, then this may be a good set of videos. This is how you earn PDUs. So these are the details that you need to provide when you log into PMI and report PDU for this session. Questions. Let's look at the questions. Let me go and see what questions I got. In addition to definition of done, we use acceptance criteria. Okay, so that is good. That is good, and I think acceptance criteria is a subset of definition of done. Definition of done is bigger than acceptance criteria. So definition of done is bigger than acceptance criteria. And let me explain you why I say that it is bigger than acceptance criteria. So acceptance criteria is related to a story, right? And definition of done is also applied to a story. So acceptance criteria is that how do we know that how do we accept the story, that functionality part of it. But definition of done may include other things. Now, in some cases, like it will be a set of deliverables. So the code should be complete. It should be code reviewed. It should be QA tested. It should be UAT tested. We should have created a automation script for this. So you can put like, these are the deliverables. If you complete these deliverables, then you are done with this story. So acceptance criteria is one of the things that talks about the functionality of the story, that this is the functionality that it should meet. But definition of done is bigger. Sometimes people use definition of done and acceptance criteria as same, which is okay. That becomes your definition of done. So your acceptance criteria becomes definition of done. But definition of done is a bigger thing than acceptance criteria. Okay, Krishna Iyer, what happens if the task is not completed in a sprint? Will such pending task be part of product backlog and should be? So if a task is not completed for a story, it means the story is not complete. Now, at the end of the sprint, that is a product owner's call, what they want to do. If this story is very important, they may say, okay, put this story in the next sprint and I'll continue working on it. If they think that particular task that is not complete and it doesn't affect the functionality of the story, they may still say, oh, okay, we'll accept it with this, we'll compromise on this. So it just depends what was the task that was not completed, and the product owner makes the final call what need to happen. Okay, Rob says, I noticed you included Scrum Master and PO in the capacity plan. Is that common? At least the PO, because the PO's time is required for multiple things in a sprint. So he need to be available to do the grooming. He need to be available to participate in the sprint planning. He need to participate in the sprint reviews. So his time is important. So I will definitely include PO. I have included a Scrum Master for the completeness sake. So that is my approach, but you can add or delete rows in this spreadsheet. This is a template kind of a thing. So use it for, you know, change it as per your needs. The key part is that you need to do capacity planning at the different skill level, not different people level. Not different, so skill level. That I think that is what is important. R. Bates, what if you have 15 Scrum teams? Does the sprint planning include all teams, or does each team? Okay, so there are different ways of doing it. The best way, in my opinion, is that each of these teams do their own sprint planning. I'm assuming if they are, each team will have their Scrum Master and product owners. Okay, so, and if the product owner is shared across 15 teams, that's a problem. Okay, then you need somebody to represent as a product owner in each team. So each team is a complete unit in itself. They will have a product owner, they will have a Scrum Master. So they complete their planning, and then there is at a higher level, all the product owners and all the Scrum Masters need to meet. So in this case, you will need a Master Product Owner and a Master Scrum Master. So those will be two additional roles. I have actually dealt with five teams in a about 50, 60 people team. So for each team, or we used to call the squad, for each team, there was a Scrum Master and there was a product owner. So they are a complete unit itself, and they do their own planning. And then the Scrum Master and product owner from each team, they go and take this output from the team and go and do at a planning at a maybe more higher level. Okay. All right. Any other question? I think I have answered all the questions that were asked in the chat box. Okay. Any other question? We have about 4 or 5 minutes left. I just want to make sure I don't overrun. Can you please redisplay claim? Okay. Can you please put up the slide? Okay. All right. Let me go back and check on this PDU slide. Okay. This is what you're looking for. Let me go and do that. So, okay. Okay. This is what you'll, and if you have registered, I think you are all registered. That's why you're here. So you will get the slide deck probably sometime today. So you should be able to get this slide, and that will be in your slide deck. And after a few days, you should get a link to the YouTube recorded part of this webinar, or recorded version of this webinar, and you should get a URL to go look at it. And all the previous webinars recording is there on YouTube. So if you are interested to go and look at the recording of the previous webinars, you go on YouTube and search for RefineM, and you will find all the videos and all the recordings from the previous webinar. And guess what? You get one PDU for listening to the recorded webinars also. So if you are looking for PDUs, you can go and listen to the webinar and report your PDUs for listening to the webinars. Okay, anything else? I'm here for another couple of minutes, and I hope this was helpful to you.